Welcome again to the Jackson Heights Church of Christ. We're grateful for your presence, and again, we have visitors. We're grateful for them, too. We have some visitors that we consider family, but it's been a while since we've seen them. We're certainly grateful for your presence also. The announcements are basically the same as they were this morning. I have one addition, and then I'll go over most of the other announcements to refresh your minds on it. Wednesday is Miss Christine Luckett's 102nd birthday. And if you'd like to call her or send her a card, Miss Luckett, she would greatly appreciate it. So remember, if you can, Miss Luckett, this coming Wednesday will be 102 years old. The Young Families Bible Study is tonight after p.m. worship services at the home of Michael and Shannon Fetters, and our ladies' Bible class will resume again. For all those watching streaming, this is live TV. Sorry about that. I'll go over that. The Young Families Bible Study has been canceled. Ladies' Bible class will resume Tuesday, September the 14th at 10 a.m. in room 10. Sandra Morton will be leading the study, and they'll study the lesson book, One Another Christianity, and all the ladies are welcome for that. Also, I want to congratulate Darren and Aaron DeHutt on the proud parents of a baby boy, Elliot James, and he was born August the 18th. He weighed 7 pounds, 3 ounces, and they were able to come home Friday night with him, and we're certainly grateful for that. Dick Sullivan will be having back surgery this coming Wednesday. Let's remember Dick in our prayers, and several of the other members that we have. Matt Basford will be having a port put in this coming Wednesday also, I believe, and at September the 1st. Betty Rochelle is going to have an upper GI this coming week. Tammy Nicholson's mother had a pacemaker put in, and she's recovering from that. And Adrian Law, Jane Law's daughter-in-law, and also Jane Law's sister-in-law, Diane Dorsett, both of them been diagnosed with cancer and then taking different forms of treatment, but surely remember Jane and her daughter-in-law and her sister-in-law in our prayers this week. Bo Carter, who's the cousin of Lynn Cole, has been put on a ventilator, and hopefully it'll only be a few days before he will be able to be taken off of it. And Ashley Bark is still recovering from her gallbladder surgery, and she had a stent put in her bile duct on it. We have others that Gail Dvorak's uncle is off the ventilator, and he's doing a lot better. And we have others that we want to keep in mind this week. Some of them are not members. Gary Jackson, as we talked this morning, who used to attend here with his parents several years ago and was in the flood in Waverly, and he lost everything that he had, and he set up a PayPal account. And again, if you're able to help him, I'm sure he would greatly appreciate it. At the present time, he's living in Columbia in Sunnyside, and Joe has his address if you want to send him a card and encourage him as much as you can on it. That's about all the announcements that we have. Again, we're grateful for the presence of everyone, and appreciate your presence tonight. One other thing, Larry Shaw was able to be out with us this morning, recovering from a concussion on a fall, and Alice gave us a card for Larry. It says, thanks to all of you for your prayers, your phone calls, your cards, your visits, and your food. We're so grateful, and God is good, and we are blessed to be able to be out again. We're certainly blessed to have them out with us this morning. This evening, the young people will be taking a portion of the lessons up this evening for a lesson, doing some reading and things on it. And let's encourage these young men as much as we can that they can go forward and learn while they're up here doing various things, and just encourage them to continue growing in their Christian life. Let's go to our Heavenly Father in prayer. Father, we thank Thee that You've blessed us to be able to be out again this evening. We're thankful for Your watching care over us, and we're thankful for the material blessings of life that You give us daily. You bless us far more than we deserve. Father, we give Thee thanks every day for the spiritual blessings that we have through Your Son, who came to this world and lived among men, for the words He gave us, the hope of heaven we have. And we ask, Father, that You be with us in doing the local work here, and be with each member, especially those that have been mentioned as being sick and those requesting prayers of the congregation. We're so thankful, Father, we have many that are improving and continuing to improve. Bless them and be with them. May we encourage them along the way to just give Thee the praise for what they are doing as far as improving. Father, we know that all blessings come from Thee. We ask Thee to be with the young men tonight and all those who are taking part in the services, that we can encourage them by being here and lift them up in any way that we can. Guard, guide, and direct us, Father, through life, and forgive our shortcomings. We ask Thee to bless our country and our leaders and those in authority to do things which are right and honorable. We pray, Father, that each one of us can live and encourage one another, that we can all have heaven in the end. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good evening. We'll begin our worship this evening with, we'll sing Agnus Dei and Majesty back to back. No, so me. Alleluia. Thank you. Next song will be Healing in Its Wings. After this song, our brother Titus Swales will come and lead our minds in a word of prayer. Do me.
Father, thank you for this wonderful, blessed day you give us. Thank you for letting us be able to come to this wonderful church building that you blessed us with. And thank you for letting us have all these people to worship with. And thank you for also letting us have friends and family. And thank you for also letting us be able to have doctors. And please help us through this pandemic and this disease. And please help us get through this. Also, please help the sick and people that need help. Thank you for also blessing us with food so we can nourish our bodies. And please help Mr. Clay as he teaches us a lesson. And thank you for also letting us be able to come together. In your name, pray. Amen.
For the lesson, we'll stand and sing number 840, Walking in the Light of God.
Safety walk, safety walk, on the upward path of God. Walk in peace.
Home in peace.
In the perfect light of God.
I want to be turning in your Bibles to 2 Corinthians chapter 9. You know what? Go to Proverbs. We'll actually start in Proverbs, I reckon. We'll see how it goes. Several of you asked this morning about Shelley's aunt and uncle, and they are still trying to put their house back together. They're going to have a container dropped at the house tomorrow. Hopefully they can get anything that's still left in the house out of the container. FEMA was going to be there today to assess the damage of the home. My cousin, my uncle's son, he did lose everything. He did live in Waverly. He was living in Waverly right across from the elementary school, and he lost everything. And FEMA cut him a check for $8,000, and that was it. And so I don't know how it's going to go for Shelley's aunt and uncle. They are talking about just bringing the track hole back down there from the barn and just push the whole thing over. And that's awful sad. Shelley's great grandfather built that house in 1870 along with the mill and the dam, and it's the house is not a historical site, but the dam and the grits mill is right there on the property. So it's tough, but thank you for all of you that asked. Many of you last Sunday were just stuffing money in my pocket to give to them, and I think I got everybody's name written down, and I'll pass that along to her in another week or so. Shelley's aunt still very much in shock. And anyway, she wanted me to tell all of you from the bottom of her heart, thank you very much. I mean, she wept, just wept, and it meant a lot to me and to Shelley to say, this is from our congregation. And Shelley was down there yesterday, and there's still just so much work to do. And so keep them in your prayers, Doris and Patricia, her uncle and aunt. I know they would appreciate it. And everyone in McEwen and Waverly. I know you see on the news the photos from Waverly. And born and raised in McEwen, we didn't like folks in Waverly. But so I do kind of now. But there are a lot of folks in McEwen, too, that lost a lot as well. In this week's reading, we'll be covering 2 Corinthians chapter 7, 8, and 9. And chapters 8 and 9 deal with the collection for the needy saints in Jerusalem. And this is really one of my favorite passages. I have talked extensively about this. I have preached an entire sermon on the collection a Sunday night back last year. So we're not going to rehash all of that. But it is a very interesting study. But one of the things that Paul is going to be tackling in chapter 9 is he is going to be encouraging the Corinthians to follow through with their promise to give this gift to their needy brethren. And as I talked about in that sermon that I did months ago, and I will talk about it in the summary for this week's reading, is I think that the Corinthians might have had promisor's remorse, is what I call it. They have promised this great gift, but now they're kind of like, oh, that might have been a little too much. Paul's going to encourage them with these words. Whoever sows sparingly will reap sparingly. Whoever sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. This very simple, self-evident agrarian principle is repeated throughout Scripture in various applications by various people. What I'd like for us to do tonight is I would like to explore a number of these passages. We can't do them all, but we're going to get a nice sampling and look at how this truth that we will reap what we sow is used throughout Scripture. I think it'll be a neat little study for us tonight. First of all, we need to understand that the principle used throughout Scripture is we sow what we reap. And so first of all, let's start out with this idea that if we sow evil seed, then we will reap an evil harvest or a harvest of evil. I have Job chapter 4 and verse 8 up there on the screen as that first scripture reference. And I kind of, maybe, when you come to the book of Job, sometimes you don't want to use the things Job's friends say, highlighting biblical truth, but Job 4 is one of them. And I know he's targeting Job with this, and it's not true of Job, but it is a true principle. As I have seen, those who plow iniquity will sow and sow trouble, they reap the same. And so if we're going to sow the bad seed of iniquity, of sin, of unrighteousness, then we're going to reap sin in our life. If we sow the seed of iniquity, then we are going to reap the same. The wise man will say things very similar to this. In Proverbs chapter 6, look with me beginning at verse 12. A worthless person, a wicked man, goes about with crooked speech. He winks his eye. He signals with his feet. He points with his finger. With perverted heart, he devises evil, continually sowing discord. Therefore, because all this is true, because he is sowing the evil seed of discord, calamity will come upon him suddenly, and in a moment he will be broken beyond healing. Or listen a little further to chapter 22, Proverbs chapter 22. And you might put a marker around Proverbs. We'll come back to it with the next point as well. Proverbs chapter 22, look at verse 8. Whoever sows injustice will reap calamity, and the rod of his fury will fail. Again, here's a person who is sowing bad seed. They are sowing evil seed, and they are harvesting evil. Well, Paul says it this way in Galatians. Let's look at one more scripture, then we'll begin to apply a little bit this to ourselves. In Galatians chapter 6, right? Flash forward to the New Testament. Paul is winding up his letter to the Galatians. Notice what he says in verse 7. Do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever one sows, that will he also reap. For the one who sows to his own flesh will from the flesh reap corruption. Do not be deceived. I know sometimes we think, okay, maybe I can needle them with this word. Maybe I can dwell on this thought for a little while. Maybe, you know what, maybe I can just be the worst kind of employee on the face of the earth and it isn't going to matter. But God's not mocked. God sees. And God repays. If we're going to be sowing the evil seed of discord, if we're going to be sowing the evil seed of unrighteousness or of sin or of heartache, if we're going to be sowing the evil seeds of hurtful words, bad attitudes, guess what we're going to reap? We're going to reap evil. We had somebody come in the other day to the post office. He came in, for whatever reason, he'd been off for a few days, and he came in, he took one look at his route, and they had not delivered, the person the day before had not delivered a little extra mail or something, whatever, it wasn't much, and you know what, he can get paid to do the extra, so he's not out anything. I need to set this story up with that. He could have made more money. He took one look at it. I'm not going to repeat every word he said, the elders wouldn't like that. And he threw up his hands, said his expletives, and walked out and said, I'm not dealing with this. I'm like, what? And he turns around and he says, I don't like them messing with me like this. I'm not going to take it. One person cheered him on the way out the door. And I turned to her and I said, do you know how dumb you're acting? I said, look at me. Look at Brent. God works across from me. I said, we never have any trouble. Management never takes advantage of us. Do you think it's because we let them walk over us, or it's because we're cooperative? Do you think that we have it pretty easy around here because we're always thumbing our nose in their face or whatnot? No. I want to use his name. Jake got this because this is how Jake always acts. Take a step back from your own life right now. Let this truth be the mirror that you're going to look into for just a moment. Do you have a lot of problems at work? It might be you. Do you have a lot of problems in relationships? It might be you. Do you just have a lot of problems in life? The problem might be you. Sowing evil seed. Harvesting evil as a result. But there's another side to this equation. And that is that if we sow good seed, we'll reap a harvest of good. Let's look at a few passages again. Let's go back to Proverbs. Proverbs chapter 11. Look with me beginning at verse 24. One gives freely, the wise man said, yet grows all the richer. Another withholds what he should give and only suffers want. Whoever brings a blessing will be enriched, and the one who waters will himself be watered. Now, verse 24, at least in the English version of the English Standard I have, says one gives freely. I think some of the other translations, like the King James or the New King James, the New American Standard, maybe in the CSB, does it say scatter? Okay, there are some translations that say one who scatters freely. So the idea is one who sows freely. Here he says, if you're the kind of person who is sowing the seeds of generosity, guess what's going to come back to you? More generosity. Or listen to what, I mean, this is the point that Paul is making in 2 Corinthians chapter 9 and verse 6. He is saying to the Corinthians, if you will be stingy, God's going to be stingy with you. But if you will be bountiful, if you will be a blessing to your Jewish brethren, God will be a blessing to you. Paul will also say something very similar again in Galatians. We'll go back to the latter part of that passage. Galatians chapter 6, look at the latter part of verse 8. The one who sows to the Spirit will from the Spirit reap eternal life. James is going to say it this way in James chapter 3 and verse 8. And I know we're doing a lot of verses, but I just want you to see how often this principle is used. James chapter 3 and verse 18, a harvest of righteousness is sown in peace by those who make peace. So time and time again, we're told if you're going to sow evil seed, then you should expect to receive evil in return. But if you're going to sow good seed, if you're going to sow the seeds of righteousness, if you're going to sow the seeds of peace, if you're going to sow the seeds of generosity, then what you can expect in return is peace and righteousness and generosity. If you're going to sow love, you'll get love. That's not a hard principle for us to grasp. But it's the more challenging principle for us to implement. Because you see, it's easy for me to say the harsh word. It's easy for me to give in to sin. It's easy for me to throw up my hands and walk out of work one day. But I had to train myself, and we have to train ourselves to speak words of love. We have to train ourselves to resist temptation and sow seeds of righteousness in our lives. We have to train ourselves to trust the Lord and be generous when we give and give to others. That's the promise. You will reap what you sow. And so let me just ask you for a moment. Just go back. In fact, this is a question. If you have one of the handouts, look at question 1 and 2. Think of a time in your life when you have seen the principle of reaping what you sow play out. Give from your own life. Give an example when you sowed and reaped evil. Be honest with yourself. It's the hardest person to be honest with. Be honest with yourself. Then follow that up with an example of when you sowed and reaped good. And then from 2, what did you learn from this experience? Why? What did you learn? And I hope what you will learn is, I don't need to be sowing seeds of evil. I need to be sowing seeds of good. Because I don't like what I get when I do evil. I love what I get when I do good. You know, it's one thing for Matt or myself to get up here and preach these concepts and challenge us with them. It's a whole other thing for you to take the piece of paper, turn it on the back page and say, okay, here is what this actually has meant and does mean to me. So here's the promise. No matter what kind of seed we sow, whether it's good seed or evil seed, we need to understand this, that we will always reap more than we sow. For this, to set this idea up, we need to go back to the book of Hosea. So let's go back to the Old Testament. I had already looked it up and put a marker there so I wouldn't be flipping. Because I can't sing the book of the Bible song very far. But if you can find Ezekiel, then you'll find Daniel. Just keep going to the right. Ezekiel, Daniel, Hosea. Here God is pronouncing judgment against Israel. And I want you to listen to what he says in verse 7. This is Hosea chapter 8, verse 7. I know we're jumping right into the context, but he is giving them a word of judgment. For they sowed the wind, they shall reap the whirlwind. The standing grain has no head, it shall yield no flour. If there is yield, strangers will devour. But focus in on that first part. For they have sowed the wind. Here is the contrast. They have sowed a gentle breeze. Boy, it's been hot lately, hasn't it? Boy, don't you like it when you're just hot and sweaty and a gentle little breeze comes through? Just cools you down. Feels good, doesn't it? Sharon says it feels good. It feels good. That's what they have sowed. But what have they inherited? What have they harvested? Hurricane Ida. That's what they got. They got a tornado. They got a hurricane. They got a windstorm. No matter what we sow, the harvest is always going to be greater. You think one thought for just a moment, you allow yourself to indulge in an evil thought for one moment. I'm not talking about those evil thoughts where we think about killing somebody. A couple of you just looked horrified. A few of you shook your head, yes. I'm not talking about those horrible thoughts. There are some social pressures that kind of keep us from doing some of that. I'm talking about that thought of, wow, that person over there really treats me better than my spouse. Or that horrible thought that says, you know, it'd be so easy to take that from work. I don't think anybody would notice, and then I could go sell it on eBay. We we allow ourselves to indulge and plant that one very small evil seed, if we don't pull that root up quick, if it germinates and it starts to take hold and we don't take care of it quick, guess what we got over here? We've got a lost job and a police record. We've got a broken home, whether we still live together or not. We've given our kids a horrible example of what fidelity is supposed to look like. And the repercussions of that go down a generation or two. We will always reap more than we sow. I mean, isn't that just a basic agrarian principle? It's a basic spiritual principle too. In fact, Jesus alludes to this in Matthew chapter 13, the parable of the sower. When the seed falls upon the good soil, there is a harvest. The one seed yields 30, 60, or 100 fold. Paul gets to this as well. Let's go to 2 Corinthians chapter 9. Where we kind of started this whole idea. I do want you to notice this. So he is imploring them, please give. We'll start the reading at verse 6. He says, whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. Whoever sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Each one must give as he has decided in his heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. But notice what he says beginning at verse 8. And God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that having all sufficiency in all things at all times, you may abound in every good work. As it is written, he has distributed freely, he has given to the poor, his righteousness endures forever. He who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will supply and multiply your seed for sowing and increase the harvest of your righteousness. You will be enriched in every way, to be generous in every way, which through us will produce thanksgiving to God. Now I know what the guys on TV say. Send me a check and God will bless you. He'll bless you greatly and richly, and you'll have the biggest house on the block and the finest car and this and that and whatnot. It's all about you. And maybe we've allowed them the space to pervert that we're a little reluctant to go there. But let's go there. The promise God makes is this. You will always reap more than you sow. Whether you're sowing evil seed or good seed, you will always reap more. Not more to lavish on yourself in accordance with the good seed, but more seed, more harvest to do more good. That's the promise he's given to the Corinthians. Corinthian church, if you will just follow through with this, don't be afraid of the sacrifice. God will bless you abundantly. He will make your harvest great. You will abound. He will multiply. Not to spend it on yourself, but to be able to give more to others. As one good brother here said it, you can't outgive God. So whether we're sowing the evil seed or we're sowing the good seed, we need to remember this. We will always reap more than we sow. Let it be a warning for the evil seed. Let it be a promise for sowing good seed. Two more and we're done. We also need to recognize that sometimes we sow now, and we might reap a long time later. I'm going to go back to Galatians. I want to do the last words of that quote that we've been hitting at twice now, Galatians chapter 6. Listen to what Paul says at the end of verse 9. He says, so he has said in verse 7, do not be deceived. God is not mocked. Whatever one sows, that he will also reap. Don't sow to the flesh, rather sow to the Spirit. Now listen to verse 9. And let us not grow weary in doing good, for in due season we will reap if we do not give up. I think sometimes we get ourselves on a big kick. So we hear a really good sermon, maybe Matt's sermon this morning. We hear a really good sermon, and you know what? We're so pumped up, and we're so excited, and we're saying to ourselves as we're going out the door, I'm going to do better. And so we go home, maybe after this sermon, and you're determined, I'm going to do better. I'm going to start planting that good seed. I'm going to be better to my spouse. I'm going to be a better employee at work. I'm going to be more generous in helping people in need. I'm going to stop sinning and be more righteous. I'm going to be speaking words of love to people. And then next month, we kind of short on money. Our spouse doesn't reciprocate our good seed of love. Supervisor at work just takes us in for an investigative interview. That's the first step of being disciplined in the post office. People aren't responding to my good seeds I'm sowing. And after a couple of weeks of that, what do? We pack it up. Forget this stuff. And we go right back into our old rut of way of living, throwing the evil seed here, throwing the evil seed there, wondering why life is so hard. Do not grow weary in doing good. In due season, you will reap a good harvest. But you're going to have to keep at it. James gives us this same idea. He says, be patient, therefore, brothers, until the coming of the Lord. See how the farmer waits for the precious fruit of the earth. Be patient about it. Until it receives its early and its late rain. Sometimes, you know what? Sometimes maybe we've been sowing so many evil seeds in our lives that it's going to take a while for the good seed to overcome the evil seed. We got to be patient. And we don't need to give up. And no matter what, you got to keep sowing the good seed. No matter what. You've got to keep sowing that good seed. There's two passages here. I want us to make sure we read them both. Let's go to Ecclesiastes, a word from the wise man. Listen to what he has to say. Man, this is just such a fantastic passage. He who observes the wind, this is Ecclesiastes chapter 11, beginning at verse 4. He who observes the wind will not sow, and he who regards the clouds will not reap. As you do not know the way, the spirit comes to the bones of the womb of the child. You do not know the work of God who makes everything. So in the morning, sow your seed. At evening, withhold not your hand. For you do not know which will prosper, this or that, or whether both alike will be good. Here he says, I know some of you look at the weather to determine what you need to do and not do. But just like we don't understand how God knits together the baby in the womb, we don't always understand God's way of working. So throw your bread on the water. Sow your seed. Do your good. Don't look at somebody or don't look at a certain situation and say, you know what? They're not worth it. It's not worth it. Sow your seed. Do your good. Because how do you know? God isn't preparing a great harvest for you in that endeavor. And sometimes it's painful. It's very painful in relationships when we've tried to do good for so long. and it just doesn't seem to be working. The children of Israel had a song. It's Psalm 126. This is a psalm of ascent. This would be a psalm that they would sing as they made their way up to the temple. It's about God restoring the fortunes of Israel. And I want you to listen to what he says beginning with verse 4. Restore our fortunes, O Lord, like the streams in the Negev. Those who sow in tears shall reap with shouts of joy. He who goes out weeping, bearing the seed for sowing, shall come home with shouts of joy, bringing the sheaves with him. Where in your life are you trying to sow the good seed? Where in your life are you trying to sow the good seed of righteousness? Where are you trying to sow the good seed of generosity? Where in your life are you trying to make a difference by doing good? Don't give up. Sow in tears. Reap in joy. If that's you, then seek the help of a friend here. Ask one of the elders to pray with you about it. Ask one of the brothers. Ask one of the sisters. Ask Matt or myself or one of our wives. Oh, that did not come out right. Ask Lauren or Shelley. Ask them. Because you don't have to sow alone. We reap what we sow. This principle is irrevocable. There is no escape from its consequences. It is a law of life. Therefore, let us be sowing the good seed of love and righteousness and generosity towards others in due time. You will reap a great reward. The Lord has promised it. Now let's believe it. And let's do it. Thank y'all for listening. Thank you for turning in the scriptures with us. With me as we study tonight. I tell you, the older I get, the longer I preach, the longer I'm a Christian, the more I love God's Word. And I hope that it means something to you that we here at Jackson Heights get back to the Bible all the time. It's the life of who we are. It's God's revealed Word to us. What that word says to us is it gives us a great promise. That no matter who we are, no matter where we're from, all of us will have to stand before the great judgment seat of God. And there we will reap what we have sown. That should be a frightening thought for all of us. It should be a motivating challenge to all of us to sow the good seed that through His grace and mercy we might reap the good reward. That's the promise of the Word. And that's one that all of us must accept. Can we help you with something tonight? Maybe you've been challenged on some level by this. Just come while we stand and sing and just say, Clay, here's what I need. And we'll be happy to help you. Won't you come while together we stand and sing?
I'm
Is there anybody who would like to partake of the Lord's Supper? To prepare our minds, I'm going to read 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 18. For Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, to bring you to God. He was put to death in the body, but made alive in the spirit. Let's give thanks for the bread. Dear Lord, we thank you for this bread that represents your body that was sacrificed on the cross for forgiveness of our sins so we could live with you in heaven one day, Lord. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Could you please stand and raise your hand? Let's give thanks for the cup. Dear Lord, we thank you for this cup that represents your blood that was shed on the cross for the forgiveness of our sins. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. This concludes our Lord's Supper. If you'd like to lay by in store, could you please stand or raise your hand?
Our closing song will let the beauty of Jesus be seen in me. And then after this song, we'll go to God in closing prayer, and Colin Swales will lead us in that prayer. If you're visiting us with us, we're certainly glad you're here with us this evening and hope that you'll stick around and let us meet and greet you. And appreciate all the words and the lessons and prayers that we've had today, and hope we'll all be encouraged as we leave. Let's be standing, and we'll sing the first three verses only and be dismissed with prayer. No me, let the beauty of Jesus be seen. Amen.
Please bow. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for all for allowing us to come together, worship you, and sing praises to you. We pray everything done here today was in accordance to your word and praising in your sight. Be with us as we depart. Keep us safe until we meet again. It's in your Son's name we pray. Amen.